Good morning. You are viewing one of a series of videos called Conversations with Mocha. Mocha is sitting here next to me. We, Mocha and I, are speaking with various people in our community who are involved in the protection and care of animals. I'm Pat Belusic, the host for this series. I am the president of the New York State Humane Association. I'd like to remind you to review the description below for links to the New York State Humane Association website and also for additional information and links discussed during this session. So let's get started. I'd like to introduce our guest, Iris Marie Bloom. Iris is a very active environmentalist and concerned about the impact of environmental problems on the animal population, which is our concern at NYSHA, the well-being of animals. And Iris, can you give a little brief description of the several organizations you're involved with, as just a little background?
Sure. Well, I founded my own organization, Protecting Our Waters, in 2009 when I learned about the fracking epidemic in Pennsylvania. So I began the anti-fracking work while living in Pennsylvania at really the epicenter of the onslaught of fracking in the East, but centered in Pennsylvania, and the impact on animals, which I'll talk a little more about later, was front and center to the absolute horror as I learned about dogs dying, goats, horses, cows, and of course, wildlife. One of the first episodes we learned about was 10,000 fish were killed in one, in just a few days. So we, Protecting Our Waters, are fighting fracking now in Pennsylvania and in New York, to some extent in New Jersey and Ohio and other states as well, but we're small, and we're fighting fracking infrastructure because oil trains, pipelines, fracked oil pipelines, fracked gas pipelines are all part of what is increasing fracking. Even though it's banned in New York, these projects are coming through New York to increase the use of the products. So we're working on the extraction end, the processing end, the end use, the whole, every phase of the process to protect animals and human health.
Okay. I'd like to understand the couple just citing the organizations that you're involved with in addition to that one. That one sounds very interesting.
I've
POW have here.
So POW, that's Protecting Our Waters.
Okay.
We call ourselves POW.
POW, okay, that sounds
and,
good.
And our theme, I'm wearing the POW shirt, our air, our land, our water, and really but trying to educate that it's not just people's land, air, and water, it's also animals, air, land, and water. The rights of nature is one of our concepts. Here in Marbletown, I'm an environmental conservation commissioner, and in that role, I'm also able to work on fighting the plastics plague, which people may, if they haven't been thinking about it too much, may not realize that is a wonderful way to protect animals, wildlife, marine life, because 50% of all plastics that are being produced are single-use plastics. In other words, 100% unnecessary. We don't need these little plastic bags. We don't need single-use plastic cups. We certainly don't need to use 500 million plastic straws a day, which is what Americans are doing. That's enough plastic straws to go around the earth 2.5 times a day.
Well, I'd like to get into that a little bit more in a bit. You caught my attention when you said you're the environmental super...
No. We have a conservation... It's the Environmental Conservation Commission.
Is that part of the Marbletown town government?
Yes. We're an advisory body, and we advise the Marbletown town board.
I see.
We've been working for a year on a plastic bag ban, for example. We just planted a big pollinator garden to support
bees.
Hummingbirds and bees and butterflies.
So the town, I just want to make this clear to our viewers. So the town of Marbletown actually, has you as part of their board?
Well, we're not on the board,
right,
but we advise the board.
But they have a lot of respect for your organization.
Absolutely.
And they take your advisements with great seriousness and act on it.
Absolutely.
Well, that's very good. I think that's a wonderful thing.
And I'll just mention to viewers, people, most of the Environmental Conservation Commissions in this town and every town in New York are always looking for new members. So people can join these boards if you have a passion to protect animals, including butterflies and bees, which, as you know, is a huge issue.
Well, let me ask you this then. You folks came up with this commission and then offered it to the board, is that correct?
No, the commission has existed for many, many years.
Okay,
so I just joined
last year. Mm-hmm. All right, so I'm not certain whether most towns have such a commission, but if they don't, folks could look at the website for the town and look at that and see how it's set up and set one up in their own town if they don't already have one. Is that correct?
Absolutely. Okay. And sometimes they're called CAC, Conservation Advisory Commission. Sometimes they're called ECC, Environmental Conservation Commission. But most towns in New York do have them.
Well, that's very nice. Iris, I'd like to hear about how did you get involved and when? I mean, what age were you at, and what triggered this interest in the environment and the impact on the animals and such? Was it a singular event? Was it a growing awareness as you became an adult? How did that come about?
Oh, it's been deep in my bones and blood and heart since I was very small. I've just always been an animal lover. I can't understand people who don't love animals. And you can't live in the world and not understand that, that wildlife everywhere are horribly, you know, being decimated or horribly impacted. So I wouldn't say there was any one incident, but I will tell you that I was called also to other struggles. So I worked on fighting apartheid, you know, I worked on human rights issues, I worked on war, I worked on racism. And I worked on violence against women. So there was always a call that was more intense, more urgent, more present, which is why it wasn't until around 2009 that I was freed up, you know, economically and energetically to do work on the environment, which I'd always been called to. And two things happened right away. One was, I went to a presentation by NOAA, wonderful, you know, NOAA, National Oceanographic and Aeronautics Administration. Everybody gets the acronym mixed up, but NOAA, right, the marine scientists. And they, this was at University of Pennsylvania, and this was so high impact. They presented about plastics pollution impacts on marine mammals. And I, like many people, have a deeply felt, you know, love for dolphins, whales, and marine mammals, seabirds, sea turtles. They're so important. And I was stunned to see that this whale had been found starving to death, even though its belly was full. And they couldn't, so scientists did a rescue, and they took it to the Baltimore Aquarium and did everything they could for it, did every test, couldn't figure out what was going on. Somebody finally said, you better check its contents of the stomach. And that whale's stomach was so full of plastic.
Oh my God.
That it could not eat. It could not get any nutrients. It was unable.
So it was starving to death.
So starving to death. And also plastics are poisoning our oceans. So that poor whale had to have all that plastic suctioned out. And in this presentation, they showed the pile of plastics that came out of that whale's body. And so some people may have seen, you know, images of sea turtles eating plastic bags in the ocean, thinking it's a jellyfish. Seabirds are dying with their bellies full of plastic. It's horrifying. So that was in 2009. And it really isn't until now that I'm able, really in a position to do something about it. So sometimes you feel a call for a long time, for a lifetime,
and then
or for a decade.
Then you finally do something.
And the town of Marpletown just made history by being the first town in the state of New York to pass a straw-free resolution. And when you think about plastic straws, it sounds trivial, right? It's almost laughable. People can make fun of you, right, if you talk about plastic straws in a serious way. But our oceans are filling with plastic. the our oceans will have more plastic than fish by weight by the year 2050.
Now,
going straw free is really important.
Now, how do you address the issue, because someone's going to say this to you, well, a lot of these towns and such have landfills. They don't put it in the ocean.
Oh, absolutely. Well, that's you know, from the Marble Town point of view, getting having less waste to haul to landfill. Our landfill, the waste is hauled to the Ithaca area, kind of between Ithaca and Syracuse.
Mm-hmm.
So the fossil fuel, the cost, the weight of all this unnecessary trash.
So if that were reduced, both the oceans and
absolutely.
The landfills would be
landfills
reduced. Right.
Full of plastic. It's crazy.
Mm-hmm.
So whether it goes into the ocean or whether it's
landfill.
It's a terrible waste issue. And the other side of it that I know even more about than I would like to know is the manufacturing of plastics, which requires what? Fracking.
Mm-hmm.
Fracked gas. Ethane is a natural gas liquid that comes up with methane when they're fracked.
Well, can you speak to that a little more detail? Because
sure.
You're making a statement that the plastics are
yes.
created from the natural gas?
From natural
obtained.
Gas liquids, which is ethane, which is
comes up
when,
from fracking.
From fracking, absolutely.
Not natural gas, but the ethane, which
so
is a bit different. Can you
when
explain that?
Natural gas is mixed together,
mm-hmm.
methane, ethane, butane, propane
mm-hmm.
is all mixed together.
Mm-hmm.
When it comes up, it's a mixture of gas and liquid, basically.
Okay.
So depending on where the deposit is, and I don't want to get too into the weeds,
right.
but
okay.
you have so-called wet gas and dry
mm-hmm.
gas.
Mm-hmm.
So dry gas is more pure methane, but a lot of places it's wet gas, which means it comes up with ethane and propane and all that, which is considered natural gas liquids. Ethane is the primary feedstock for plastics. So as long as 50% of our plastics are single-use plastics, I mean, I'll tell you that the chemicals industry and the plastics industry are completely in bed with the fracking industry in order to keep this all going.
Mm-hmm.
So fracking, as most people know, is tremendously destructive of water, of air, of climate, of land, of soil, of human and animal health. So we can talk more about that.
Right.
But also then the plastics manufacture involves poisons. What makes plastics soft is endocrine disrupting chemicals.
Yeah,
phthalates.
Yeah,
and our rivers and our streams and our bays and our oceans are getting more and more endocrine disrupting chemicals in them, so that we now have intersex fish in some of our rivers.
Yeah, can you explain that term?
That means that their fish have the capacity to change sex according to the chemical impacts on them. And so we now have places where we have, instead of having male and female fish that can properly spawn and reproduce, we have all one sex, or it's all out of balance.
They have an inability to mate properly.
Absolutely.
Okay. Now, when you and I were discussing before we started the filming, you were mentioning the impact of fracking, not only on the wildlife where they do the fracking, but also on surrounding farm animals and pets.
Absolutely.
Can you speak to the pets thing? Because I think a lot of people don't realize when you say that the pets are impacted, the dogs and cats that live in the area. Can you speak to that for a moment?
It's almost a little bit hard to talk about it without crying.
Okay.
The impact of fracking on dogs in particular is one of the things that, when I learned about it, upset me so much.
Mm-hmm.
One example is a farmer, blueberry farmer in western Pennsylvania,
mm-hmm.
where they were dumping fracking flowback on the roads because it's so high salt that they were using it
clean the snow, right.
And they would dump it at inappropriate times, I'll just say that.
Mm-hmm.
And it should be illegal, this practice. So the dog went across the road and then licked its paws and died very painfully not too long after that. Some of the stuff that's in fracking flowback includes arsenic, it includes acetone, it includes glutaraldehyde, it includes radioactive materials. It's quite a toxic concoction.
Now, I know in a lot of time, I know the Ulster County has refused to use that on the roads.
Absolutely.
So I think we're very good. I think a lot of counties have done as well.
Yes.
To refuse to use.
But everybody should double check and make sure that your county is refusing any use of fracking flowback.
Are the companies that are offering this stuff, are they offering it free? Is there some way that they're trying to make it appear this is a good thing?
Absolutely.
Also, they're giving it to the counties free, trying to create a kind of a good public relations thing, if you will. We're giving you this, you can save your money on salt, kind of thing.
Right, they're counting on ignorance.
I see.
So we can't afford, we just can't afford to be ignorant.
So you would advise our viewers to check with their counties and make sure that this ridiculous, poisonous stuff is not being used on their roads in the winter.
It's good to double check.
Okay.
But the larger point is that if your home is heated by oil or gas, that's part of the problem. So basically all natural gas is fracked.
It didn't used to be all fracked.
So the high volume type of fracking is relatively new.
Right.
So that really exploded, for example, in Pennsylvania between 2004 and 2011. It just increased so dramatically. And that's been the case across the country. But that is the case now because there is no more of the shallow, easy to access
natural gas.
And oil. Those deposits are gone, so we have gotten to the point that every kind of fossil fuel that we're using can rightfully be called extreme energy, meaning it's extracted using fracking or mountaintop removal.
Well, until the time really, and we hope that comes, that there are really a large number of alternative sources, such as the sun or what other energy we can harness from solar, people have to heat their homes with something. So it would seem that if there were more available of the old style natural gas, but it's gone.
It's gone. And people don't understand that.
Oil is still a problem too,
It's a problem more than ever. It's a problem more than ever.
So during that period, it looks as though we're going to be continuing to use fuels that, but move towards alternative fuels.
Well, everyone who can should switch to Ethical Energy or another company that gets their energy, their electricity, from solar and wind, because everything we do to increase demand for solar and wind helps the economics of the clean energy economy. So renewables are rapidly outpacing dirty energy, and we can all help that by paying, really a lot of us, just a few pennies more on our electric bill.
So currently that is available.
Yes.
So with the fact I'm not sure what word I'm looking for, but they are now required, like Central Hudson, to offer you different carriers. And you're suggesting that
Ethical Energy, for example, is one.
Company that's providing you currently with your energy, look at the alternatives that they even present, they have to, you know, that are available to you.
Right, and you could just Google Ethical Energy and figure out how to switch to it, and then Central Hudson has, if you're in New York and you're
Citizen,
they have to honor that.
Right.
And so that's one way, and that's just, you know, generally pennies a month. It's usually a little bit more expensive.
And that would increase the income stream to those companies that are working to do alternative energy and present them with more money so they can do that.
And so, it's a win-win also in terms of energy efficiency. So everything that that you can do to increase the energy efficiency of your home, simple things, cheap things, you know, plastic over the windows in the winter, weatherizing, anything that, you know, wrapping your propane tank with a blanket, There's all kinds of cheap things then.
Now, what about propane? You just mentioned propane. Is that clean?
No, that's dirty.
Dirty.
Absolutely
okay.
Dirty. It comes from fracking.
Okay.
So we need to use as little of it as possible if we can get to zero.
Because I know there's a lot of people that have to rely on propane to heat their homes. And I don't know if there is an alternate source for
well,
that.
So there's no clean propane.
Oh, that's
absolutely not.
That's,
no clean methane, no clean propane.
Okay.
So those people that have the ability and can really do the math and figure out, oh my God, if I get solar panels, I can reduce, I can almost get to net zero. A lot of people would be surprised that when you crunch the numbers, and right now you can get huge rebates if you go solar, and there are some companies that will install solar for no cost. And so you're essentially getting a loan to install solar. So there are a lot of options right here, right now. We don't have to wait for someone to come along and literally knock on our door and tell us you have to go solar now. Certainly lots of people can't do that for one reason or another. I'm a renter. I can't make my landlord go solar, but I'm paying my utility bills, so I can pay that through Ethical Energy. And certainly I can winterize and I turn stuff off. Here's the simplest thing that you can do to save animals in terms of energy. If you make the emotional connection to the fact that electricity from the normal grid comes from, a lot of it still comes from coal. That means mountaintop removal. They're blowing up mountaintops. Can you imagine how many animals are destroyed?
The habitat is
destroyed. And that's precious. So people who leave their computers plugged in all night, their Wi-Fi plugged in all night, their all kinds of appliances that are just plugged in all the time because we're a little too lazy to lean down and unplug it. Or to reach over and unplug it. Or flip the switch.
On the strip.
Get a strip and just flip that switch. And that's 10 to 17% or more of our national energy is from appliances that are running that don't need to be running.
Okay. Now, you also mentioned that fracking is related to the climate change itself in one of your earlier, which I read that you had written, that it's related to the climate change. And can you speak to that for a
Absolutely.
Moment? Absolutely.
Fracking is a major contributor to climate change. That's because not only is there a huge amount of energy used to frack.
Right.
So just bear with me for a second, but if you go through the process, first they clear, right? They're clearing so many trees. Then they pave. Then they drill a mile to 2 miles horizontally. Can you imagine how much energy is used in that process? Then they drill horizontally. Then they frack, which means explosion. Then they're using 5.5 million gallons average of poisoned water per well per frack. All that water is carried average of 1,100 trucks. That's all fossil fuel. Then the product comes up. Then they separate it. Then they process it. Then ultimately it's transported one way or another to where it's used. Every single stage of every step of the way creates climate impacts. And so methane is 105 times more potent as an impact on climate. It's a greenhouse gas that's 105 times worse than just regular carbon. So people don't realize that. They kind of think of coal as dirty and natural gas as clean. Why? Because our minds have been so impacted by the industry saying clean natural gas, clean natural gas. At the tailpipe, it's a little better, but throughout the process, it's so much worse that it's actually increasing our climate change very rapidly.
Well, thank you for explaining that. I'm very impressed that New York State did ban fracking.
Yay!
And do you feel that New York State's stance will impact other states?
Absolutely.
Will it encourage activists to, because there was a big demonstrations. There were several big demonstrations up in Albany.
Yes.
And everyone got involved, the singers, the speakers. Mm-hmm. I mean, we had a tremendous response
right.
to that.
And I was part of that, you know,
good.
Being in Pennsylvania.
Well, I figured you were.
Helping get the workers and the farmers and the impacted people to come to New York to state, to describe their experience with
right.
fracking. So Pennsylvania was the poster child for why not to
why
frack.
Not to do this.
Yeah.
And do you feel that New York's stance is having an impact on these other states? Do you think there's enough folks there that are anti-fracking that can carry the day like we did here in New York?
Well, the reality is, let's be honest, as long as New York allows new fracked gas pipelines, new fracked gas power plants, and new fracked gas, fracked oil pipelines to come into our state to carry fracked fossil fuel, right. then we're actively, rapidly undermining our own fracking ban. We're basically doing a frack your neighbor's policy.
Mm. But we'll carry it across the state. I mean, that's the name of the game. They want to carry it across into New York from the other areas.
So many people who have been involved fighting fracking in New York State are appropriately now fighting pipelines, fighting power plants, fighting the oil trains, and fighting, I'll just hold this up for a minute, this is very important, the Pilgrim oil pipelines, which would, if they are approved, run right from Albany down,
right.
down
the
along the thruway.
Right.
It is completely insane. They're known as mm-hmm. the preposterous Pilgrim pipelines. They would be carrying fracked oil from North Dakota mm-hmm. shale fields, which, by the way, one of the most horrifying interviews I ever did was with the rancher, Jackie Schulte, whose animals were rapidly dying and who herself had health impacts from fracking for oil in North Dakota. This is the oil that you hear about that keeps blowing up
right.
with oil trains. So five times as many oil trains would be coming into Albany to service the Pilgrim oil pipelines if they are approved. And the spill potential, mm-hmm. you know, pipelines spill three times as much oil as any other method of transportation, more than trains, more than trucks, more than boats, more than tankers.
Well, what do you feel is the main reason why this is even being entertained here? Is there big money here going to, it's usually all revolves around money.
Absolutely. So these are the big boys. These are the two heads, the president and vice president of Pilgrim Pipelines are both former Koch Industries executives. Koch Industries is one of the biggest oil companies in the world, and they're really, they own more than, they're the largest non-Canadian investor in the Canadian tar sands, mm-hmm. which are the worst of the worst in terms of extreme energy, fossil fuel extraction. And they're in it for the money. They're
so you feel that somehow
the
they're going to impact the legislature and
oh,
the
we're watching it happen.
And do you think if there's enough pushback on the part of the environmentalists like there was with regard to the fracking, that the governor might?
Yes. Well, that's what do you think I've been doing for
right.
the past?
All right. That's
so,
the name of
yes.
the game.
So
pushback.
We actually
right.
have 30 resolutions opposing Pilgrim pipelines that have been passed in New York State already. Rosendale was the first,
mm-hmm.
and then quickly New Paltz and Kingston, and
mm-hmm.
but it's in all six counties: Rensselaer, Albany, Greene, Ulster, Orange, and Rockland
mm-hmm.
County. So we have a six-county route for these pipelines. So we now have towns, cities, and villages all along the route that have passed resolutions saying we want to stop the Pilgrim pipelines. However, we don't have the power to stop these pipelines just through resolutions. We actually need the state legislature, the governor in particular.
Could
to
the
stand
governor
up and say
do
no.
this by himself?
Yeah, he could right now
he
say
could
no.
Yeah.
He could say no. Right
mm-hmm.
now, he could
mm-hmm.
deny the permit. And he could instruct the Department of Transportation, the New York State Thruway Authority, and in particular, the New York State Thruway Authority.
Mm-hmm.
to deny the permit for Pilgrim pipelines. And I'll just hold this up one more time so people can see information about this is at Stop Pilgrim Pipeline.
We'll get up a little bit, every situation, okay.
Yes, Stop Pilgrim Pipeline.
So folks should go to this and they'll get ideas about how to organize their own communities, get activists contacting the governor, and perhaps get the same coalition of people that were involved with the anti-fracking.
Yes, absolutely.
And you feel you're making progress in that direction of getting a lot of people
activated. We're making good progress, but we need, you know, if we have 1,000 people involved now, we need 100,000 people, because this this is the Keystone of the East, basically.
Mm-hmm. Well, it seems to me that the counties going along here are the ones that are in danger, and we aren't really getting a benefit out of it.
Oh, absolutely. It's all risk and no
benefit. It's all risk and no benefit
all
for
risk and
those
no benefit.
Counties all along the way.
Yeah. And just before, I think it sounds like we have to close up pretty soon. I'm just going to mention that while we're talking about this, to some folks, it may seem kind of cerebral. And for me, the impacts on animals has always been the thing that when I wanted to take a break, and I work a lot of 100-hour weeks for, you know, maybe if I'm paid 3 cents an hour, you know, that might be my pay rate. But when I want to rest, what comes into my field of information is someone's dead dog with a tumor that that dog should never have had, or somebody's goats that died horribly, or the cows, 17 cows in Louisiana that they drank fracking fluid that was 99% water. You know, it was half of a percent of that was the fracking fluid, and they died agonizing deaths. And those are the deaths we know about. We don't really necessarily see the pictures of the wildlife that's also dying, and is getting into the whole food chain. So those of us that love animals,
There was that excellent film that was made about Dear Governor Cuomo about the fracking thing. Are you aware of that powerful film like that?
Oh, of course.
Is there going to be made, or is it in the works, or is there one?
Well, there are a number of films being made. Okay. There's a short film that's about to premiere, and it's made by John Bauermaster, who lives right here in Stone Ridge. And he's made several, you know, he made Dear Governor Cuomo. And so he's making a film about the fracking infrastructure, including the Pilgrim pipelines. So
and
look out for
including the
it's
impact
a short.
On the animals and everything, just like...
I don't know the content of the film.
Okay.
I haven't been involved in making it.
All right, but he did an excellent job on the
right.
Governor Cuomo, so I'm expecting that he'll do an equally good job on this.
Yes. Now, I want to mention, because a lot of people don't make the connection between the impacts on animals and climate, and the overuse of plastics and fracking. You know, it's a little abstract for a lot of people. One book that I really recommend is The True Cost of Fracking by Michelle Bamberger. She's a veterinarian. And Robert Oswald, who's a microbiologist. And it is the best book for people that want to testify about this and continue this fight and understand the impact on animals. It's the impact on animal and human health. And that was why we banned fracking in New York.
Right.
Because we finally had 330 studies documenting the impacts on animal and human health.
And the book, The True Cost of Fracking,
yes.
Where can they purchase this?
It's available through Amazon.
Through Amazon, okay. All right. Finally, do you feel that there is a strategy, or perhaps there is already in place, to organize the environmental groups, the animal groups, everybody into a powerful force, or in terms of a voting bloc? Or do you feel that the Green Party's already done this?
I don't think the Green Party is the primary organizing force necessarily. There are coalitions. So, we, Protecting Our Waters, organized something called Shale Gas Outrage in 2011, 2012, and 2013. And we had over 100 allied organizations.
Right.
And we saved the Delaware River Basin, which is a huge river basin that includes New York City's drinking water, Philadelphia, but also a lot of rural communities. We saved the Delaware River Basin.
by this coalition of
organizations. Absolutely.
Oh, so there is.
So we have tremendous power and impact. There's no doubt about it.
Mm-hmm.
So people are. We just had the March for a Clean Energy Revolution in Philadelphia last week,
mm-hmm.
July 24th. We had 10,000 people. So we are coming together, and animal rights activists have been part of the anti-fracking
mm-hmm.
movement from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
To the extent that people get it, that this is not just our drinking water, this is animals drinking
right.
water, this is fishes drinking water, this is birds drinking water, yeah.
And finally, is there an event that you would like to make our viewers aware of that's coming up that you feel they would be interested in and like to attend and support?
We have had so many events, and we've just come through a series of events. But the next one, I'm helping to organize it, but I don't have the details in front
okay.
of me. It's in New Paltz in mid-September.
Okay. And they can find information on that in that Pilgrim website?
Not yet.
Not yet. Okay.
No,
but it will be there.
Yeah, I will have to give you the information so you can link to it.
Okay.
But there will be forums in New Paltz, Catskill, and Saugerties in mid-September about the Pilgrim pipelines, and that's very important for people to get directly connected to that struggle. We have to stop these pipelines.
Well, it makes sense to me. We stop the fracking, we got to stop the pipelines. Well, it's been great talking to you, Iris. Thank you very much for coming.
Covered a lot of ground.
We did, and I think our viewers will find it very interesting. And remember to subscribe to our video series, Conversations with Mocha, by clicking the subscribe button below. Also, you can request to receive notifications for each video by clicking the button next to the subscribe button. So thank you again, Iris. It's been
a pleasure.
Thank you
very much, Pat.
And
a pleasure.
Thank you to our viewers for watching.